close the door. Welcome, everybody. This is the Making the Most of Grad School, Getting In and Beyond, roundtable session. I want to start this a little differently than we've been starting other things, so if you can appease me with a little warm-up. Very light. If you want to move, you can. If you don't move, you can stay seated. But if you want to stand up and just like shake out, fingers and toes look like. Just move your toes and your shoes. Fingers, toes, wrists, ankles, since you've been sitting all day. Other direction. Elbows and knees. Get your blood.
Drink
again in your body. Okay, under your shoulders. Just the whole socket. Is anybody else dying from sitting all the
yes.
time?
Yeah,
right. And go the other direction. And then just open your feet out a little bit and then just put your hands on your hips and then go the whole way around and like wake up your hamstrings and your hips and feel how old you are. Okay, and then just wake up your neck, just do a quick yes. And no. And then all those other angles in there. Great. Okay, we're going to wake for different night down. Okay, so the three University of Iowa dramaturgs in the past 2 years are running the session, Molly, myself, and Luke. But we have some other friends here that are going to help us like facilitate the conversations and just kind of figure out what we want to talk about. So I want to do a quick little intro. So I'm going to ask us three and our friends to introduce your name, your pronouns, what program you're in, and what like kind of your status in that program is, like first year, second year, I just finished, I'm going, and then maybe like where you currently live. So I'm gonna just start, why don't we Iowa friends go real quick, and then our other three folks that are gonna help us facilitate, we'll do it as well. So do you want to start, Luke?
Sure, Luke Daniel White. I attend University of Iowa in Iowa City, entering my third year. And I use he, him, his pronouns.
Great. Morgan Grambo, she, her, hers. Also entering my third year at University of Iowa, currently living in Boston. Not during school year, I live in Iowa. Molly, can you give us name, pronouns, status in relation to and school and what program?
Yes. Hi, my name is Molly Winstead. My pronouns are she, her, hers. I just finished my program at the University of Iowa in Dramaturgy.
Yeah. And then you're probably going to see.
Yes.
Yeah. So where she's at.
So can we have our other folks, Yasmin, do you want to go?
Yeah, my name is Yasmin Mikhail. I use she, her, hers pronouns. I'm currently based in Chicago. In a month I will be based in Austin, Texas. I am going to their MA PhD in performance and public practice.
She, her, hers. I just graduated from the University of Arizona with my MFA in generative dramaturgy, and it's been like a month and a half, and still coming down on the whole thing. I am currently still in Tucson, Arizona. I work as the artistic coordinator at Arizona Theater Company, and that's what I'm doing for now.
I'm Patrick Kenny, he, him, his. I just finished my first year in the MFA DFA program at the Yale School of Drama, and before that I did my master's at University of California, Santa Cruz, currently based in that lovely little town of New Haven.
So that's who we are, but we want to kind of get a feel for who you guys are. So if you don't mind, like a little bit of like a poll. So you got these little stickers that are kind of telling us where you're at a little bit, but if you are currently enrolled in a graduate program, can you raise your hand? Yeah. Well, you're going, right? Yeah. If you just got in and you're going in the fall, also raise your hand. Okay, great. If you are currently enrolled in possibly also a PhD program, raise your hand.
Yeah.
Awesome. If you're thinking about attending grad school, maybe peripherally, anywhere in your brain, but have not yet attended. If you've already attended a graduate program, raise your hand. If you teach in a, or advise or work in a graduate program, raise your hand. Yeah, that's what I figured. And if you are just here to observe and have no affiliation with any graduate thing at all, raise your hand. Oh. Yeah, great. Amazing, right, okay, just curious. Amazing. So before we go into our conversation, we figured we should like define what we're talking about when we say making the most of grad school, because that is a very like vague term. So folks that have thought about this a little bit, do you guys have any like idea about what that means, maybe just to you, or what that definition means?
Stick
to life. Okay. Yeah, good.
Okay.
There was some commotion. Can you read
the question? What do we think we're talking about when we say maybe, I guess, the most of grad school?
Yeah, do you have a thought?
Yeah, so when we're thinking about academic institutions, they're not always set up in the way to totally support students in every capacity. And there is a thought that grad school can be a scam. So when I think about making the most of it, I'm very much coming from the perspective of how is this degree and these letters going to give me a credibility to not only find my people, but be better equipped with how to articulate my goals and the specific discipline that I'm curious and willing to be a part of as a new, as a student again, and making the most of it, finding the ways to thrive in a program when it's only set up maybe for survival.
I think something that I thought a lot about before entering the program and continue to interrogate as I'm in my program is how am I feeding myself artistically, educationally, every step of the way? How can this program really help me unlock all that I want to in myself and the artists that I collaborate with?
Other ideas?
Building on what Luke said, I had a wonderful little kind of like crucible for thinking about making the most, in that almost before this, I was in California for a week seeing my friends, and then the week after that, I had a family reunion, and then a week to kind of think about those things anyway. So I've been doing a lot of like talking about the last year of my life to the people in my life. I would say, to me, making the most out of it, and this might be a little bit of an ambivalent answer, is having the flexibility to change your expectations and kind of just live in the moment. Especially, I think even the first day we started at the School of Drama there, you know, there was kind of like the claim that you are the future of the American theater. And that kind of position of the future, like, you know, I'm gonna meet my lifetime collaborators here. I'm gonna meet all these things. And the person I was when I presented my application, they accepted me as like the person that I'm going to be, except better in 3 years. And, you know, expectations change. You change. You learn things. You fail. You grow. And being willing to accept that change in expectation, that shift, and that, you know, you might shockingly have different interests, even just a year and 6 months, and a month in, you might be a completely different person. And being willing to accept that new version of you and trying to think of the most way you can be that person is really wonderful.
I would say, just coming off of grad school, I feel like the 3 years were a very selfish time. Like, pretty much everything is about you, and people like throw money at you sometimes to do more of you stuff, and it's really exciting. And I would say just kind of lean into that as much as possible and soak up everything, whether that's knowledge, contacts, experience, money, any of that. Because it really is about you, and if you at any point feel like it's not, that's when something needs to change, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Do you have anything you're thinking about?
Yeah, sort of jumping, I missed the first few, so I apologize if I repeat anything that's already said, but jumping off of soaking it up, the thing I would say that I learned in my 3 years is to really take advantage of every thing that you can in the security of that institution. And that means taking advantage of the things that are sort of like right in your path, but also looking for mentorship and collaboration with faculty and other students who aren't necessarily in your program, and to find those meaningful relationships that aren't sort of slapdash right in front of you on your first day, and also to take advantage of the ability to create outside of the educational institution and to do your own sort of projects with those collaborators, or to sort of step away from those systems every once in a while, like Luke said, to feed yourself artistically. If you need to break away occasionally, you should feel free to do that.
I think just listening to all your guests as well, I think my thing around making the most of it is a question that we had in our little Google Doc of questions. It's just like, how do you make it worth it? Like, or just like kind of what you said, yeah, sort of like survival, like it's intense. So like, how do you actually make it worth the time, stress, money?
Moving to a new place.
The sacrifices and what you gain. How do you calibrate all of that? So I think that's kind of where we want to base a lot of our conversations today. Of if you're on the precipice of thinking about going to grad school, maybe this will inform that conversation.
Does it have to be a precipice? No,
for those of us that are
here, I'm about to take that first step.
And for those of us that are in it or on the backside of it, is like, what do we have that we could possibly share to help those folks? Or in our own institutions, what are our challenges that we maybe aren't making the most of, or our resources? Any other definitions that you guys are thinking of, and when you think of that, like making the most, that you haven't heard? Doesn't have to be, if it's a specific question, we'll definitely go there. But if it's just another thing you that popcorned up for you, great. Let's shoot ahead.
Yeah. We're hoping to curate three different conversations today, working in small groups. And so the first thing that I'd like for everybody to do is to form small groups where there is at least one of every color in that group. And let's try not to have too many greens in one group, or too many yellows, or too many reds in one group, so that we're sort of spreading that experience across the room a little equally. And we're going to talk about the before and the during, so looking at What are my questions about applying to grad school? And then what do I need to focus on? What are my questions about, okay, great, I'm in grad school, now what do I do? So we can move the chairs around. Let's look at what groups of four or five.
It seems like there's like four folks that have done it and four folks that are in, so maybe we should try to aim for four groups.
Okay, yeah, great.
Cool.
So I'm a person that's yellow.
Yellow.
So we should not be yellow. Okay. Yellow and red.
My BA is in dramaturgy, a double English lit dramaturgy. And then I worked an internship for about a year and a half right after grad school, and then I totally derailed. I guess my concern is like the steps I need to take to bolster my application going forward. I know what I have to offer, and even though my resume may be a little bit stale, I want to kind of figure out how to supplement that with what I know that I know.
For me to like, do things that I want to do, so I'm just like curious about.
Are you guys thinking about that stuff too, about your resumes, as you're kind of prepping?
I find my questions, the more I've been thinking about this, a lot of my questions are stemming from my own lack of research and the ignorance on types of programs. So that's on me, but hearing about the types of programs you guys work with, what I want to do, that would be helpful.
I'm a director of graduate studies at St. Cruz. Before that, I worked at Kernan Miller. Where are you from? I guess I found a group of
Yes. Nice to meet you. Yes.
You're also Lindsay Barnes?
Yes.
I was like, what, Lindsay Barnes?
Yeah. There is one letter. I'm A, she's E.
Okay, great. Oh.
Katie, Olivia, and Morgan.
I get a lot of students who apply who from very broad backgrounds,
right?
Especially recently, we've been getting a lot of international students, which is great. But a lot of international students are in a situation where they have not been able to pursue arts career, because of the living that they live in or whatever, and so they've been doing something else like mechanical engineering, right? So the question is, when I am evaluating an application, I'm basically looking for three things. Okay? Number one, you should write this down because this is the key to it right here. Okay? Number one, can they do the work? Right. So I know what the curriculum is. I know what's going to be required of a person to do it. And my first question is,
Catherine's going to come in, you're going to say,
all right, fine, can you do the work?
I'm already an MFA.
The second question that I have is, will they follow through?
Done a lot of graduate applications.
Will they finish what they started?
I had to make the choice between your patient and your graduate return program. So I just
have a lot of third questions.
If you have like any kind of run the gamut of graduate experiences.
Because I'm going to invest a considerable amount of my time, resources, and personal energy into the cultivation of this person. Are they going to be passed, right?
And
of course, if I'm an MFA, that complicates things, right? But I generally am not, so.
I want to know,
nice question. So you're apparently okay. I'm not interested in your experience, except insofar as it answers one of those three questions. Right? So one of the things you can talk about is, yeah, I've been working in a very high stress environment for a long time. I'm really good at getting things done. Similar too, right? So I can answer, that's evidence that you can finish when you start. But apart from that, what I really want to know is, what do you want to do in the future? What do you want to do, you know, as a dramaturg or whatever it is that you're going into? Right? What do you want to do with it? And do you have a background that justifies that? Because, you know, it's just like, you're saying, I am going to make it all about you for as long as I can, as hard as I can, right? So the clearer you are about what it is that you want, the better. So one of the things that I always advise people, and I'm sorry to take you is that if you find somebody that you would like to work with, like somebody wrote a book that you're really interested in, or somebody work that you're interested in and find out where they're teaching, and then do they have a program? And if they do, like, what kind of program is it? And that's one of the things you can front line here. You know, hey, if somebody wrote to me and said, like, hey, I read your book and it made a huge difference in my life, I'm going to be like, oh, really? How flattering. And I'm going to be like, actually, okay, so what? Now you can't bullshit that, because if you do, I'll immediately see it. But if it's genuine, I'm going to be like, oh, okay, cool, I can help you, right? Like, I can find a way to really advance you in the world. So that's what I want to know, right? So,
Can I add one quick thing about if you're thinking your resume kind of appears kind of bizarre to people you're applying to? So I worked in finance at Roundabout Theater Company for grad school for dramaturgy. For a lot of people, that was like not conducive in their brain. So I had spent a lot of time figuring out my narrative of what that meant for me.
and for everything I do, my dramaturgy is like umbrella. So I was like, okay, so what's the umbrella that connects finance to dramaturgy? And I was like, actually, it's curiosity and it's patterns. And like, I love an Excel doc that tells me something, and I love an Excel doc that tells me something else. Like, so that could be a scene chart or it could be like sales. So I mean, I just had to spend some time figuring out why people were confused about what they were necessarily seeing. And I did find some people to do a little bit of dramaturgy for just before I applied time, and I was exhausted because I was working full time and freelancing, but like it was what I did to kind of bolster a little if you're worried about to stay on this. But I had to figure out the narrative of what's the connection. And I had that prepared for when I went in for the for interviews, because they did want to know what that relationship is. Like, how can you feel satisfied over here and feel like you did this thing? So yeah, that's a small
office. Absolutely, yeah, that's absolutely right. So it's not automatically you. You haven't done any dramaturgy specifically for 10 years. It's not automatically you. But it's better if you have done something. Right, and if you can also, when we come to the third question, that's where your letters of recommendation come in. So, you know, I recently had somebody apply to our program, and their letter of recommendation was from their supervisor at Starbucks. And I was like, that's very little value to me unless they're really addressing these issues, which they did not. Right. But so, you know, so if you have someone that you're working with,
speaking to the,
like you do a little freelance for, and work with somebody to write a letter saying, yeah, I mean, it seems like Catherine's been out of the game for a long time, but her dramaturgy is pretty sharp, and she did this and this for me. That's helpful. But on the whole, yeah, more important than anything is having that's really, say, like, I was talking to Catherine Balanchine about her work as an economist and how dramaturgically informed it is, and how it's a way of and if only the people in the conference would listen to what the people who are selling tickets are saying, they would learn a lot. So, yeah, especially if dramaturgy is dramaturgy.
Yeah, I felt like that's what I would have to just tell people. I'm like, do you know what dramaturgy is? Because it's exactly what we're doing as we're looking at this stuff and making decisions or asking questions. Like, that is what it is. Do you want to talk about programs? Is that what you're saying? Like, just like, how do you pick what program you're looking for?
Yeah.
Do you mean degree or like both?
The way that the program is styled. Like, I found through my studies thus far that I much prefer doing like physical work rather than theoretical in academia.
Okay.
It sucks my soul to write a paper that I know will then bear no physical creation. It's sort of where I found myself.
So generally, you want to as opposed to an MA.
Because
an MA is generally designed to be a feeder, if you want to go on to another terminal degree in arts administration or a PhD or possibly at an event. Right. Like I turned Pat over there and he wanted to run. But that is not necessary or recommended. And then the second one, to find, like I said, someone whose work you're interested in. You want to go work. That's the best way to do it.
And how long have you been out of undergrad?
Oh, I'm not. I'm going into my senior year.
Okay. So I would also spend some time investigating, like, if you can get that practical outside as well. Just like, as you finish, so just like, can I find the place where I can do that like grad school level practical work without? So I will say, so my program, Iowa, has kind of an extreme focus on extreme. I enjoy it, so that's why I went there. Practical, like I'm in the person every day. So like there are certain programs that kind of help like make it very public how much of the practice rehearsal room that they do, and Iowa's one of those. But I also will say I spent like 3 years outside and was doing a little bit, and I actually did want to go back for some academic rigor, so that was like part of my decision to go back. But it's at least balanced. Like, you do get into the room.
I was also speaking to the history stuff. Having like a crazy, like, after my first round application, I was discussing it. I think it was like a really big thing.
we're probably getting close to the end of this thing. Any small things? It's okay, there's like three more. We're gonna like round robin this thing. So even if you want to ask a different person that same question, you can. We just figured it would be an easier way to get other people. Is there any questions? So those are kind of beforehand. Any during question you guys are thinking about? I can offer one. Oh,
no,
yeah,
no,
one.
I'm thinking.
I guess I
was able to.
I have a curiosity around
change
mentorship. I don't know. It's something you kind of bring up and try to find out who you want to learn from. But it's something that I've been thinking about a lot. Trying to find an advisor that works for you. Or just like, just find people that can give you advice. Not just like your academic advisor, but. I don't know if you guys have thought about that at all.
The advising question is kind of my plate right now. I graduated from Skidmore College, a super small liberal arts college in New York. And I'm going to enter into a program at U Chicago, which is a much, much larger school. And I'm kind of terrified trying to find and seek out an advisor on my own, having not taken classes or spent 4 years because it's only a year-long program.
Yeah.
So,
can I ask you what drew you to Chicago?
Sorry?
What drew you to that program?
They accepted me.
Oh, yes. Okay, that'll do.
Oh, yeah.
But also, so I...
Yeah.
No, so I studied English and theater throughout my undergrad, and I wanted to go to a school where I could continue to do both of those things in two different departments and continue to kind of mold them to me. And I looked at Columbia's PhD in theater program, which was great, and I loved that, but I also wanted something that wasn't a six-year commitment at this time in my life. And UChicago is a place I could do it. It's a Master's in Humanities, so it spans all of their humanities departments, and you can kind of pick and choose what you want to take and where you want to take it, and who you want to take it with. And so I love
that's
that.
Very cool.
Yeah, I'm really excited about it.
When do you start? Normal
September 15th.
Very cool. I would be curious if they're on like our LMDA. I don't know if you guys have gone on the Airtable. Hopefully on the LMDA's website, it has all those filters for you to select. Like I'm looking at just in the Facebook swipe their DM. I'd be curious to see if like what types of programs are kind of orbiting.
Yeah.
Those like official ones.
I found it through their PhD. So I'd applied through their PhD and they bumped me down to EMA, which was totally fine. Great. Where I should have been to begin with. But yeah, I wonder,
curious. You should go take a look. I was like running around in that the other day, and I was looking because I know they updated it last year, and there are so many programs. So I was like, oh my gosh, so I guess like, you're
really
awesome here.
Quiet.
I'm off around here, and I have to go. I would pop back in because I think there's even more.
Megan called me up and she said, I don't want to do this anymore. So I'm doing it. So that's my thing. I'm just going to be in charge of
it. I was also so many. And I was also so surprised about how many programs had like Dramaturgy coursework, even if it wasn't like that official. Because I also think
was
that was
not a thing 15 years ago.
My undergrad didn't have any Dramaturgy coursework. So it's also something to think about as you come out of an undergrad that actually did like focus as well. So this is the majority of my formal education in Dramaturgy beginning grad school, which I don't know if that's everybody's experience, but.
It's only been since 2004, 2005, but there have been a lot of undergraduate degrees. That's a great. Where are you?
I'm at Iowa.
You're in Iowa.
So I'm entering my third year at Iowa, and we only have three graduate students, but next year when Luke and I graduate, they accept two. So that would be good if you're listening. But I guess I'll just quickly say something about Iowa is that like I found that that program is working really well for me. I wanted to do replay development and we are members of the Playwrights Workshop there. We are kind of inextricable from that. It sounds scary to like move to Iowa. I guess maybe not from Chicago, it's only like 2 hours west. But or Iowa City's like three. But it was a big change. But I found that like the mix of academics, the mix of practical, who was there. I got lucky with my cohorts good. So I think that it was kind of a leap. So as you do look, that I guess this is kind of an unsolicited advice of like that little leap into the
But I want to respond. I just want to respond to what you guys said about mentorship. I love mentoring students. It's why I became a professor. I love students. I love working with young people. It makes me young. I'm busy. I'm so busy. And I go to a big state school, right? I do a big state school. So when, you know, when I was at Carnegie Mellon, we had, what, like 20 students. I got to know them very, very well. And if they didn't hand in an assignment, I would go chase them down. Why didn't you hand in an assignment, right? I can't do that anymore. If you come to me, I'll bend over backwards. But you have to come to me. And so that's what I'm saying about when you're going into Chicago. You find somebody who you like, who you want to work with, you go get them. And bug them.
Yeah.
Be polite about it. I'm so sorry to bug you, but I'm bugging you. And you said we could have a chance to talk about this. I was just wondering if it happened, blah, blah, blah. That's your first test. You break through that barrier, and then as soon as people get to know you, then they'll be like, oh, I've got to help this person. So, you know, same thing with go chase
them. Yeah. It's definitely, it's funny because different programs seem to have, like, different levels, and I don't like to use this phrase, but, like, hand-holding, and, like, it's not one of those. So it's, like, you got to advocate for yourself and for your own... and for feedback and for responding.
Because it's supposed to be a professional training program,
yeah.
Right? And, so, and as professionals, you have to go after what you want. You're saying, people just don't feel
like yeah. I'm going to talk about Molly for a bit. If you guys have any final questions, oh, she's about to switch. Are you going to switch?
Did you have another question?
I thought you were.
I wasn't.
Okay, can you do it now?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Okay. Everybody, can you round out that question? And then we're going to like musical chairs to another group where you can either ask similar questions or you can start a new conversation. Yeah. Do you want to take it over?
Yeah, so we're going to try and keep the same sort of spread of color in each group. So we're not going to conglomerate yet, but we're going to switch it up so you're speaking to new people. And if you were talking about sort of the before and getting into the during of grad school, let's switch to the sort of during and maybe the after of grad school.
Cool.
So if you want to say where you are, you can do that. But for the most part, let's change these circles that we've got.
You want to switch it?
Yeah.
Luke, come over here. Sorry, I'm going that way. I mean, you can still go with me.
It's one population
I'm
kind of I've been in a bit of a limbo state recently. I just went abroad this past semester, so I haven't had academic advising really for 6 months. But yeah, I get more of that until we get back in the fall.
Nice to meet you.
What is yellow? Just remind me that you did a graduate. You're in, and red means you finished.
I finished. Got it.
Would love to make a graduate.
Yeah, let's
circle over this way.
We kind of moved over here so that we would be more photogenic for the holiday. Yeah,
wonderful.
We go way back.
Oh, yes. Full session.
And you're Alex Hanson from New York?
Yes.
Are you holding on? Sorry.
Oh, no. It's not my session. Well, I guess I am on the bench. Oh, but you, yeah. I need to introduce yourself and where you're based.
Yeah. Over there, we also did ages and just like where you are in terms of grad school.
Sure. I'm Alex.
I'm Carrie. She's her hers. I'm based in Chicago. I have very mixed feelings about grad school and whether I would want to attend or not, and if so, when.
I'm Courtney, she, her, hers. I'm also based in New York. I'm currently looking at applying for grad school starting fall 2020. I am a little kind of lost in that, well, A, I finished undergrad in 2011, so it's been a while, and B, I got my BA in theater, and I'm looking for an MFA in creative writing, so I'm kind of wondering how to navigate that, considering that's not where my connections are.
Daniel White, 26, he has pronouns. I'm in my, going into my third year at the University of Iowa in dramaturgy.
Awesome. Great program. My name is Michael Chambers. He had radio keys. I'm 340 years old. And I run the graduate program at the University of California, San Francisco. The MA and the MFA program. And we're trying to build a program. Just something to think about.
My name is Yasmin Nicolai. I'll use you in I'm 23.
How do you know?
Moving
into
MFA.
One of the solid pillars.
Yeah, it starts like that.
Trying to
stay excited about it. It's a big move. I think a lot to talk about when they start. I definitely feel very early for careers, but yeah, I'm also grad school and really figuring out if it's a thing to do and when you do it. It gives you option tests and figuring out if you want that option to get your exam or just that you have whatever path. So like, it's really not a teacher. So I need a terminal degree, so that means my question is that MFA or PhD. So it's a stepping stone.
Can I ask why you made the decision to go with the MA PhD route versus the MFA route?
Yeah, so I think part of it was insecurity. I applied to the same two programs 2 years in a row. So the first year I was waitlisted at the other school. I got a beautiful letter on what to expect in my application. And then the second year I had Hogwarts for Iowa. It was really cool. So it was really cool to see, like, how can I push myself to grow in like the year of becoming good enough to actually get into both of the programs, and a little bit of the insecurity of being so young and not maybe being ready or welcome into the MFA program. But it was after actually being accepted and visiting UT that I was like, damn, I probably should have done the MFA, and like, I don't, there's not really a path to that yet. So maybe why I'm just like, knowing within yourself and being empowered to like apply to a right now, and it's sometimes sports like, I don't know how to, so for MA, PhD, for MFA, there were some students that started IGC as MFA and then stayed for the year. I didn't realize that that was a common pattern. It's not something I could have known if I was more proactive in talking to different students. So that was something I learned a lot more, like, hunting them down. What does it mean to be fully funded? Oh, if we're not fully funded, if you feel CA shift, that's different. So there's crisis that occurred too. With things that you think you're proactive about, like knowing the thing of like grad school, going on a crappy thing, that is
real quick question. So I'm a big fan of education for education's sake, in that like I am a big fan of thinking that we should stop thinking like a degree is at least a job, in that like it's, you know, like, right? You know, so like in that regard, but in that regard, when it comes to application time, the feeling I get is that the tone people want to read is like, I have this exact idea of what I want to do career-wise, and this is the degree that'll help me get there, and yeah, so am I wrong in that? Like, do they want me to be definitely very goal-oriented?
So when I'm reading there's three questions that I want to answer. Number one, does this person have the chops to get through the curriculum that I know is ready for?
Right.
Number two, if I accept them, will they follow through on what they have promised to do? If they're going to commit to this program, are they going to go all the way through? Because if they drop out halfway through, that's a huge waste of resources and time. Plus, it takes a slot for somebody else. Right? And number three, are they an asshole? What I need from your application is to be able to determine that the answers to those three questions are right or yes. Or yes, yes, no. Yes, yes, no. Yes, yes, no. So, seriously, I'm telling you the absolute truth. Okay? So, So, but one thing I want to say in response to what Yasmina just said is that, and this is important, it's not your job to decide whether you're good for a particular program.
Yes.
So when you're thinking about, that's not my job. What you should do is go, God damn it, I want this, this is what I want, I'm going to get it, I'm awesome. So it's my job to figure out if you're not right? And my responsibility. So don't take on that job for me because I'm getting paid. You just apply for what you want. You reach out and grab it and focus on that. Don't undercut yourself, right? It's too late, but it's okay. Keep it in mind.
So a lot of like this session is like how to make the most of the test for the and I think coming from my background of like how people work so hard and making spaces where there aren't necessarily room for me or sometimes passing person of color, sometimes not knowing job stability and money is something that super motivates me as coming from a personal stance. So like I already know within my biases that money motivates me, stability motivates me. So even if being an adjunct makes me feel stable, it's still better than freelancing 7 jobs plus working full time for the last job. And that's all it's for. I don't mind any better.
Oh, I see. Okay,
I've been learning a lot more about what's going on.
You mean like, oh, there was like,
and you're actually, yeah.
Then
you
it's
like, why do an MA? So if it's just going to be non-paying degree, it's not going to be a good job. Maybe that's why there are so few people hiring an MA program.
Yeah, or you have to know, like, looking at who's on your panel, like, why not to be tokenized on the side? It's like, what maybe the people that are the only people that will launch that now that are hiring an MA? A lot of the crunchy talk to people that are working on all ends of it, but it's also having the money to support that and being transparent about what you actually have to support them. Talking about the program that let me in, historically they have 2 MAs, 2 PhDs that I visited them on my acceptance. Like those were the people in the room. But now, the way that the program has shifted out after the final offers of this thing, there are 5 MA students.
So, I mean,
this tells me that with undergraduate tuition, where they're usually making their money, they need another batch to get the money from. That moves to undergraduate students, they're recouping from their MA students who no longer have to
pay for it. But you have another question.
I did not.
Please really answer. Yeah, just basically like when applying, like if I'm someone who I'm still making questions and decisions about a career, like I want to know. Yeah.
Exactly. So what I want to know is, are you going to follow through? Right. Now you can communicate that to me in a variety of different ways. So you could say, I want to do this. I want to do this. This is how I'm going to do it. I'm going to get it. And I'm like, wow, they are motivated. Although if you're wrong, that's going to be really apparent, right? You're like, I am going to study Barney the Dinosaur because I want to be a paleontologist. And you're like, oh, no, no, right? But if you want to say, I am a proponent of knowledge for its own sake. I am on a path towards self-actualization. I'm so lucky that I have that for sure. And you people are the ones I want to do it with because you're awesome. I've read your work and I'm excited about the things that you're doing there, and that's what I want to be. And that can be just convincing. Right? The question that we're trying to answer is, will you?
It's like far enough that I
okay.
Know.
That's really helpful. Yeah. Especially
as someone coming with like a specific CEA that has somebody out there, like even for me as someone who's super into dictionary, I was talking about like what are the methodologies and tools that I bring to you that you maybe don't have and how I'm going to ask that and how I might push your program.
Yeah, that's a good thing. Right.
Yeah. As like filling the gaps.
I get that sort of thing very rarely, and it's great to get that.
gap. You can say like, oh, I've noticed that you guys might be trying to build a little bit better in this. You know?
Speaking from my own experience from applying, I think I have a 3-page statement of purpose, and I would say 95% of that was me just talking about my experience and interests, and specifically how my interests would be met at the university, and I think 5% of it was my vague notion of what I might do.
That's another thing too. I have an idea. You don't know enough about the field. But we actually have space for that too. You come in, when I applied for my PhD program, I'm going to write about this. And they were like, great. And 3 months later, I was like, I'm never going to write about that again. And they were like, this thing is your project that would change my mind. You know, so that's, there is flexibility built on that. But tell it in a way that creates a narrative that makes us feel like you're worth the investment. Right? What you can bring to others also.
I'm fine.
You know, you would ask, when's the right time? When should you do it? And let me say that of all the people that I have known, who've been to grad school, my students, my classmates, myself, the people who had a good time, who got a lot out of it, they're people who know I need to do it. So more important, I'd say, than talent or chops or anything, is life.
Thank your people in your current group. We're going to shuffle again. And contrary to what I just told this group, we are going to, again, maintain different colors in these groups. So find people, ideally, that you've not yet sat in a circle with.
Michael, let's get together in this.
Let's just be
I am, but I literally just graduated.
Okay, alright, well, I'll tell you.
This is great.
I go by MC.
MC?
Yes.
That's cool.
Thank you.
Well, my initial school is MC. That's it. There's a homonymical last. Jordan?
Yes, Jordan.
From Chicago?
Yes, live in Chicago, currently undergrad.
Where are you from?
Charlotte, North Carolina.
Where?
Wake Forest.
Oh, yeah.
Where are you? Hey, you guys are all on here.
Yes.
Up for Rebecca. For the win. For the win.
I'm Lauren. I'm from
Aurora,
Illinois, but I went to
Grand
Rapids and just
graduated
like
undergraduate degree. All right. Well, I love presents. Okay, how are you?
When do you like to
I am Patrick Denny, Yale School of Drama, and I'm proud alumni of UC Santa Cruz twice. So this is a little bit of a knowledge overlap, but I think hopefully a fruitful knowledge overlap.
Yeah, well, if I say something that's bullshit, you can say that's bullshit.
Okay,
so, what?
Where are we? Have we sort of covered the getting in, looking at programs, questions? Do we solve more those questions?
But what are things that you're still burning to know? Even if it's still like, no one answered my question about this specific program, or you know.
Well, I mean, I typically say this on every group that I've been, just want to have like another answer. I am still my undergrad, and in the fall, I'm hoping to apply to PhD programs, because that's my end goal. I want to be in, I want to be a professor and have a PhD and work as a scholar. Is there any need, or is there any recommendation for there to be like a little bit of a break in between there to do an MA, or is it valuable to go straight into the PhD?
The answer to that question is it depends, like most things,
sure.
But many PhD programs require an MA.
Yeah.
However, many PhD programs also provide an MA.
Yes.
So if you come in without anything, you can enter into your PhD program, and your first year of it or so will begin. Which is actually a pretty cool thing, because then if you discover that you can't stand these people, you can take your MA and go somewhere else. You know? So in other words, don't worry about it. If you find PhD programs that you like, have fun. And they'll let you know, right? Well, I'm sorry, we got me a little better in May. But, you know, I'm trying to build a PhD program right now, and we have an MA already. And we're going to use that MA. You can apply the MA, or you can apply the PhD, and if you don't have an MA, you can get the MA.
Where are other folks in their kind of like process of thinking like that? So just kind of touch base, not so really well.
I am also in my undergraduate at Aquinas College in Grand Rapids. I'm majoring in computer for social change. I'm at this conference just to kind of like get my feelers out about where I could, what direction I could go in for an MA. So I'm more or less concerned with like the process of finding a detailed program and like how to apply for that, rather than jumping into my PhD. Go you, that's so cool.
You know you want to be a professor.
That's amazing.
Awesome. So I would say LMDA, and specifically, it's supposed to be me, who's doing it, keeps a record of all the programs in America that offer dramaturgy and coursework. It's from undergrad to MA to MFA to PhD. It's a searchable database that's on our website, and so check it out. It's part of what you pay for already. To be, I think it's free, actually, but I know it's under. I'm personally updating it. We'll just get up there a couple months ago. There's 72 separate programs. So actually, you can get a deal. And then the other thing that I really want to advise is find someone who's worked your age. Just for you too, right, Jordan? Find someone who's worked your age today. Depending on what you want to do, if you see someone out there who's doing that, find out where they are. And then see if they've got the program, right?
Find out where they went to school as well, because if they share this scholar that you're super interested in.
Exactly.
I can share that too.
Yeah, that's right. And sometimes you can write to petty people and say, I want to be just like you. Where did you go to school?
Right.
And they won't answer you. You know?
Especially if you throw out compliments.
I heard writing a letter is always better than like email or whatever. Oh. I can't remember where I heard that, but like handwriting a letter.
I think I've said this in a couple different places. That is a way of like demonstrating effort. And I think a lot of like showing that you're serious about something is, you know, the ways that you can demonstrate that effort or demonstrate your commitment to, you know, getting your degree or like doing this work. And perhaps writing a letter by hand shows I am taking the time to open my pen, put it to paper, put it in an envelope, go to the post office, and come back and call me. Like, oh, that's an investment.
Yeah, I would be very surprised if I were, you know, but, so I would pay attention to it. Instead of like, hey, I don't really know who you are, I saw your name on this website, and I'm just like, what's your record?
I was going to say, do you get a lot of those emails?
A lot. And I'm like, that's your answer. Here's where you can find out.
It's right, the website.
That's right. Another thing you can do is you can figure out where you want to live and then look at the university that's there and see what kind of program you're in. So every university that has a credit program, they have a website that details what they want you to know about that program.
And every university has alumni who also is in that job fair.
And something I said to the last group that I want to say again is that Yasmin was saying that she hesitated to apply to an MFA program because she's very young and she thought she couldn't handle it and blah blah blah. And what I said to her was, it's not up to you to decide whether you're good enough to get that particular grad. That's up to me. I'm getting paid to do it, right? So you write to me and you go, what your job is to go, I am such a badass, I am so awesome, I'm going to be such an asset to you. program, and I'm going to fully follow through on what that I do, and I'm going to pass it. And then it's up to me to decide whether that's true, right? Don't pre-select yourself out ever for anything. It's not your job. Go get what you want. Go reach for it. You know?
And sometimes
people are upset. You don't deserve it. Come on. This should be true. Right? Nice.
And just say no to drugs as well.
And say no to drugs. Or this is not in place for
everything. Of course. But what are some other questions that are simmering? Or are they hurting other groups that would like to challenge or share with us?
So there are ways to do it.
Lauren, you haven't said anything.
I'm kind of new and recent to the dramaturgy game. I've been working as a dramaturg for a theater presentation project for 5 years now, and I have some dramaturgy positions lined up in Grad as a projective year, so I'm kind of seeing if I like it a lot. I'm just kind of seeing if it's something I'd like to go to grad school and I'm not sure
if I'm going to grab my
grad. Yes, we're at the same school. I just graduated.
Well, you know, of course, you don't have to go to grad school to become a dramaturg, right? You can just do it, which is how I learned that, you know, because there were no programs where I was there. And so you don't have to go to school to do it. It helps though, because first of all, you get networks, you get mentorship, and they're saying you get a period of time when it really is all about you, which you still have to fight, you know. Don't get me wrong, it's like grad school is never a walk in the park. It's always hard. There's no way to take it hard. But you get a lot out of it, and you get this intense study. You can.
And because it's a space of learning, it's also a space for the ethics of things. You know, you have to get everything perfectly in. I always have, not necessarily a safety net, but a support system where when you're having problems, you have people whose job it is to be your mentor to teach you.
Like, I'm not going to have that statement. Just like, oh, here's my last impression.
Because if you already knew everything, you'd be doing it. Right? Like the whole premise of our relationship is that we know how to do something and you want to know how to do it.
As far as like my portfolio, but
so if you go to grad school, tell someone last year, take your time, decide whether you want to go or not. But if you decide to go like hell. And charge into it. And go, I demand to suck all the juice out of this. Right?
Nothing substantial because.
If you don't do that, if you go in there ready to be displeased and like, I don't really know why I'm here, why am I wasting my time with this, why am I doing this? Lots of fucking people. Always hard, but I loved grad school. I loved it. And it was because I love the challenge. I love the
crazy.
I love the people. I love being able to work with people. You know, crazy people doing crazy things.
No, no.
It's because I was driven. It wasn't because I was smart or talented. It was because I was driven. Because there were smarter, more talented people than me in the program. I feel like that. They didn't know why they were
there. The career's there.
What are your questions about the
signature? I'm going to go over this other back. And this is a lot, so it looks like it's done. So,
either a gap year or taking an MA to a PhD.
I took a gap year to the it was both like the fire and the
ice. So it was like a letter, probably would have heard about it from a letter. But it also spoke to
I know. I mean, I needed it in the 4 years. I was on the verge of really burning out.
Choose your letters carefully.
It was also the time I needed to know that I'm not on this creative environment. And I can't do that. So
I think that
I wouldn't say that. I also think, though, you have a family.
Unless you put it in front of the center, I'm not going to be
I know specifically for me, I'm in a dramaturgy program, and I'm very eager to try getting rid of some of the dramaturgical tendencies that I don't think are valuable in my career. My program is very like new play and practitioner like focused, and my brain, how it works, is more like scholarly, and it's like I'm a translator. I am interested in classic works, like all of this stuff, and I just need to escape from like focusing on with playwrights. I think it's a valuable skill, but I think specifically for me, it's really trying to go to another academic institution to find ways that I can let go of those tendencies and accept some new tendencies.
Don't leave this room without even
talking. I will.
Not to name the bias either, but I also. I feel like I took a year. I did go right into the Santa Cruz MA program there, but it feels like very much when I did the program, it was still in the phase where it was almost thought within the culture of the department as a glorified fifth year. Yeah. And the majority of our students were people that were coming. We had wonderful students come in that weren't from the program, but the majority of the students were just students from Santa Cruz that went on and did this. It was a great year. Not club, but they do have still have good funding.
Oh yeah,
they have great funding.
I just rolled all
funded, and it provided me a wonderful space to figure out what on earth I wanted to do with my life. And then, in between finishing my MA, I had 2 years of layoff. I had initially turned. It was 1 year that turned into 2 years, but it's really productive 2 years. So my first year, I was definitely high on my high horse. I was very cocky. I was very, and I didn't. And that was a rough like 2 months. April, May. We can say April, May, June, 2018. Now 2017, not a great place for me. Michael can attest to that. But then, I got a point. So I do think time can be a really important thing. And time doing, I made coffee for 2 years. I absolutely loved it. There are ways to kind of...
Well, Pat says he made coffee for 2 years, but he was also working as a dramaturg and working with Philippa Kelly in San Francisco on theater outreach to underserved communities and stuff like that. So it's like he wasn't just playing video games. He was working towards his goals and making contacts and continuing to impress not just me but all the other people, so that somebody would call it to me and say, like, do you have anybody that's friends in making sense? That's the case, right?
Folks, so we're
going to
wrap up and kind of come into a big circle.
Finish
your thoughts.
Yeah,
absolutely.
We'll play video games for you if you want.
We'll kill you.
About a God of War classic sim.
So it sounds like we had a bunch of robust conversations, and everyone got to hear a variety of perspectives. I just kind of want to first ask, what's something maybe that's like really struck you about a conversation that you had, a bit of advice or something you heard for the first time that just like you really needed to hear today, and maybe just share that with the group briefly. Yeah.
Just like a bit of what Michael said to me in that, like, I was talking about, like, I'm afraid in applications if I don't have a specific idea of what I want to do for my career that they won't think I'm motivated. And Michael was like, you can tell them you're on a journey of self-actualization and you're into knowledge for knowledge sake. You can be truthful. You just need to find a way to communicate that you're also willing to put in the work and make the commitment. And I was like, oh, thank God, because I didn't want to lie through my teeth. So that was good to know.
Starting a relationship like that with a lie is not a good idea.
Yeah.
Because it will come out. It's an intense relationship.
Yeah.
Yeah, please. Hearing that the GRE isn't something that determines your admission, it's like a burden off my shoulders.
Especially not in drama.
Great. Yeah. Others.
Try to do well.
Other things that just were particularly useful that you want to share to the group?
Yeah.
I asked a question about like personal statements and like how to like structure that and like, tell your personal story. And Shelley offered like a sort of like formula that I could like break down and use. But it was like talk about like your philosophy and like what flexibility is inside of that. The subjects that you're interested in, using an example, and like choosing that that's probably like the strongest thing. But then just like, how are you compatible, and what your next steps are. And I think that was just really like enlightening to like have that and then to like think about if I'm looking at a place, like these are the things that I want to match up in different ways. So.
Thank you.
I've read a few.
I want to also give an opportunity if you have if anyone has a question that you didn't get to ask in a small group that's still on your brain, or a question they've already asked that you just want to pose to the group as a whole, we'd love to hear those now.
Okay. Cover down.
Great.
So I came here because I wanted to hear what people are concerned about as an administrator of a grad program and someone who's trying to build other ones. So I'd like to know, like, and this has been really helpful just listening to people's questions, but what do you wish was different about the process of applying to grad school and approaching grad school and getting through grad school? Like, that would be easier, right, Shelley?
Mm-hmm. No question.
Can I offer something from a current student
yeah.
that has watched a process of people getting accepted into a program? I think a larger focus on different perspectives with folks that are currently in the program in mind, like looking at who we have and being like, who do we not have? And just like an acknowledgement of hearing the current students on that, whether or not it's achievable. I mean, I'm specifically talking about Iowa. Iowa's a hard place to have necessarily people want to move to, but I mean, no offense, 10 minutes from Iowa, we love it. But just like an acknowledgement of hearing us. Yeah, just an acknowledgement of hearing us on like, here's who we crave to work with in our program.
Oh, you want us to be more responsive to you?
I guess, like as if you ask us who we think would be great additions, or maybe even ask that question to your students.
Waive the application fee.
Unfortunately, we have no control. SCSU has control, but I'm wondering if there's a way. Maybe that's a good question for the grad affairs, because it's like, I have, on that side of it, I have no control over how much it is, whether I can waive it. But usually I see that it's waived quite a bit, so
yeah.
I don't know that process though.
So this is a good thing to know, right? So yes, me and everybody, you can ask the grad division specifically to waive your application fee. And you'll have to come up with a reason why that they should do that. But that absolutely isn't something. We want to give away all of our knowledge for free. That's what we want. We want to be paid, but we don't want you to pay. You know, I wouldn't run a grad program if I couldn't do full funding for all my students, right? I'm lucky in that regard that I have that ability.
And the accountability and the responsibility. Like, kudos to folks that are on the ground being like, no, we can't. It needs to be funded. And there's people standing up for that. So
yeah.
We need more of that.
Right. I mean, if you can't pay for grad school, that's great. But nobody should.
No, you should pay for any school.
Yeah. That's right. Well, like Elizabeth Warren.
When it comes to accessibility of information, like, you know, during the applications process, and this varies from program to program. Some programs are really on it. They're very warm and inviting and shoot out materials. But what a common experience is, what I'm sort of running into is, for instance, you go to websites and there's outdated information.
Mm-hmm.
Like, a lot of MFA programs have out. Like, I saw a 2018, like, open house day, and I was like, guys, like, so it's like, in that, like, I need to know, like, a graduate school is like actively looking for their next graduate students, and that they are pushing out information and they can't wait to update. And so, and again, that's specific criticism towards specific schools. Some are really on top of it, but a lot of them aren't.
Mm-hmm. I can speak, you know, for our program, we have a terrible group of staff who do that work. And it is a big problem. But is it an indicator of the fact that we are not on the ball? Yes! So, you know, so if you notice something like that, then you can expect that school, and I'm speaking from my own school here, to have those kinds of problems all the way through.
Right.
And, yeah, we have a big staffing problem that's all the way across the board. So absolutely, we should be, it's a relationship, it's a give and take, and you should feel wanted. And so if you don't in the process, that's a good sign that this is not a good school.
Got it.
Yeah, we have one person at the dean's office that is handling all this, and it has to be funneled through the chair, any changes. Anyway, it's like, they make it really challenging.
Yeah.
But I agree, I hear you, that's really good feedback for me to take to my chair to be able to say, you know, can we...
Right.
And some departments have like even got so fed up that they start their own, which is not so great just to have their own website that's different from in a different style anyway. But we're doing a revamp because it's, yeah, it's our public face, so it has to be. So thank you for that reinforcement. I can take that back and be like, yes.
Yeah. If you could write an email to the graduate director of the program saying, I really want to apply to your program, but there's so little information that I decided to apply to you instead. Then I can take that to my dean, and I can go, we're losing students to Yale. She would have applied to us if we had a better website. That's how they lose. Don't do that.
Along with that, keeping your faculty lists up to date, who's on sabbatical when, and that would be great. Researching programs and staff and faculty that you have is a big
I would also add full financial transparency for funding scholarships.
Yeah, that is something you guys got to be careful of, right? Certainly, because grad school is not a scam. It really isn't. But, at least most of the time. But
I did think on that.
Yeah. But it's really important to be 100% really, really clear about what your financial obligations are when you go into it, right? And if you have any questions at all, demand the answers, right? Mm-hmm. You know, my program, we're very lucky we have full funding, but not for international students. I just found this out, that there's an additional fee for international students, which is quite substantial. It comes out to something like $15,000 a year. And, you know, I told a student who's from Iran, for Christ's sake, that he was fully funded because I thought he was. Now, all of a sudden, all this money has been gone, right? Now, we ripped ourselves inside out to help him, and we're doing it. We're able to cover him, but that's going to be like, so now we put it on the website. If you are an international student, please be aware that there's this other stuff that we can't do anything about. So, you know, hopefully we don't get surprised by that yet. But yeah, so be sure.
Great. The last thing we'd like to do with our just a couple minutes here for myself, my fellow Iowa cohort, and our friends that are helping us today facilitate this, we wanted to just go around and maybe share just like one thing of unsolicited advice. We've all sort of been meditating on this that we'd like to share with you all. Shall we just go around?
Sure.
I suppose my piece of advice is have a hobby. especially, I can't speak to other programs. I can say that the Yale School of Drama can very much feel like a very insular, all-encompassing part of your life, and to have the activity that perhaps gets you out into the wider community, mine is Ultimate Frisbee, is a godsend. And it's a way to kind of definitely strike that work-life, self-care, all the wonderful millennial buzzwords that are truly, truly important. Way to live your life?
I have two really small ones. I would say don't be afraid to go geographically much farther than you ever anticipated, because it's provided a really good perspective shift. And then I'd say, I kind of just want a second, that, like, you can't lose track of the big picture, so you have to like eat okay and like continue to work out if that's what you do or whatever, like, because you have to fuel your body during school and you can't take 3 years off from taking care of yourself. So, as I've learned.
Mine's similar. Well, the first thing I would say is in interviews, interview the people interviewing you as much as they are asking you questions. Ask them everything. How much money will you give me? Can I do this? Can I write this? That kind of stuff. And then the other, to go along with that, is put the personal health infrastructure in place before you begin. Like maybe the summer before, start eating well. Whatever that means, whatever your personal health things are, go find a psychologist or a therapist or something before you need them is huge. So all of that stuff, think about before your first day of grad school, because it'll be a little bit easier if that personal health infrastructure is in place when you need it, and you will at some point.
That is great advice.
class. I wish someone had told you.
Me too.
Entering, but yes, me.
Oh, yes. Bother current students more than you feel comfortable doing so. Because they are the first responders of the truth and like their full experience. And even if you're bothering folks that admissions people have set you up with, go further, because a lot of the times they're shutting you up with the students that will have a lot of positivity to share. So I've had like a nice swing of trying to figure out what is actually, what does it feel like to be here, live here, breathe here, work here. And they're the ones that are on the ground in the program. So bother them way more than you think you should.
And they, I love to talk. I love to tell people about my experience. So you're not really bothering them.
Yeah, jumping off of that, we want to be bothered.
Yeah, we both
do. We want to be able to share that because it helps us sort of reflect on our own time in our program. My piece of advice would be if you're going to grad school involves a big move somewhere, do whatever you can to get on the ground more than a week before you start. Give yourself a little time to figure out, okay, what are my places going to be when I need coffee? What are my places going to be when I want to go get a drink with friends? And make that place a home before you have to make that place your school. Because you're going to want to be able to separate those spaces a little bit and have a feel for where you are once you get there.
My piece is, I think, one of the greatest values that we have as dramaturgs in theater and on, you know, collaborative processes is being advocates and being agents of change. So not being afraid, once you acclimate to your graduate program and figure out the landscape that you feel empowered to make the space what you want it to be, and if there are problems that you can be an advocate for that, and that hopefully grad school can be a better, healthier, safer space for not just yourself, but those who come thereafter.
Can I just piggyback on that?
Yes.
Because there have been times when my students, I think, in some ways are like, well, this is not going well, but I'll just keep going and keep going, and then I don't know that things have been bad for a year, you know what I mean, or whatever it is. So not that you have to like shout out on every little thing or whatever, but if something is not going well in a class, you know, whatever, you could see that it's more than just sort of a flash in the pan kind of thing, let your advisor know so they can do something. They can do things, but if they don't know, like I remember like I had a student go out and do an internship, and by the time that 9 months was over, they was like, that was really terrible. Like, okay, well, I would have wanted to know like month two and not, you know, not month nine or whatever.
Well, we went a little bit over. Thank you so much for being with us. Just wanted to make you aware that LMDA has a guide to dramaturgy programs on the website, all available to us as members. It has every program, who's in charge. It's a great resource for all of you to like really get a good list of what's out there, as well as comprehensive dramaturgy bibliography and you. Caucus source book all online. And make sure you're a member of an ECD, the Early Career Dramaturg page, to continue.